I'm going to be looking at the impact of the man in the family, the impact of the man and the woman in the family as well. But I'm going to be focusing a little bit on the men, because I know that when God catches men, things turn around. When the men are set in the right direction, the women also become better for it. Now, there is a lot of attack on the family right now, the family unit. God started out populating the world with one family. I know that the scientists want to disprove that. I know that they want to say that, oh, we came from apes, or we came from evolution. There was a big bang, something, and all those kind of theory. There was a joke about a man and a woman. The woman got married to this man, and this man was an atheist who doesn't believe that there was God. So he believed that men came from microorganisms that became apes, and then that became man. And then the woman believed that God created us in his own image. And so there was this time when the woman has completely taught the children, say, listen, you were created in the image of God. You came from God. And therefore, the son also got taught by the father that we came from apes, and we came from monkeys and stuff like that. And therefore, so the son was confused, and he came to ask the mom, said, how come you said that we came from God, and then the father still insists that we came from apes? And the woman was a little confused. She doesn't know what she was going to say. She said, don't worry. He said, you know what? That, and when your father said that he came from apes, he's talking from his own side of the family. From my own side of the family, we came from God. Praise God forevermore. You know, sometimes the children will ask you questions. You're wondering, how are you going to answer this question? So that's the wisdom God has given to women. Let's celebrate women in this place. Amen. But there is an attack on the family unit right now. You must have heard about the Supreme Court ruling, as the case may be in the U.S. But I want you to know it goes beyond that, because there is an attack on the family unit. There is an attack on the definition of what a family should be. And then every community, every society is created from what the family unit is. Every time you see something wrong in the society, it's a reflection of the aggregation of what is going on in the families that constitute those communities. So that means, if you look at the situation in northern Nigeria today, the Boko Haram situation, is actually as a result of a broken down family system, where the children of those days, and when all those guys believe that they just need to give birth to children and populate, somebody who doesn't have a job has 20 children, and he doesn't even have any plan to take care of those children, and those children are left on the street. Then the boy who grew up on the street, who has seen cold eat, you're seeing human cruelty, where human beings will treat that child with all kinds of disdain, to people not giving that child food. That child has spent 30 years or 25 years on the street. Now, so if you say that child is just going to grow up to be a normal human being, then you must be kidding me. So if that child gets some semblance of purpose, of somebody just telling him that you could do something that will make God proud, and then he gets some salary or some money in exchange for that, what do you think that child is going to be? Now, that child has no value for his own life. How do you want him to have value for the life of somebody else? Because he has seen people die. He's seen people get crushed. He's seen some of his friends get knocked down by a drunken driver, and that driver runs off and nobody stops that driver. He's seen all kinds of wickedness that you can see in the world for 25 years, 28 years of his life. So the problem of terrorism, as we call it today, is a problem of broken down family systems. And we need to understand that, because if we don't understand that, then we'll be shooting in the dark. If we don't understand that, we will be addressing the symptom and not addressing the root cause. God wants to use every single one of you sitting here today to shape society. And one way he's going to use it to do that is for you to start from your home. It's for you to start from your home. Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me, not only for me alone, he said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. No wonder Paul said something to the people, to the centurion who wants to be saved. He said, believe in the Lord God and you will be saved. And said, you and your family, you and your household. So God has not somehow, I don't know right now, God included your family in his plan. For some of you who are not so proud of your family, your family that you came from is actually an entrance to your purpose, because you did not choose that family. You didn't choose. One of the choices you did not make for yourself is the choice of who your father or mother is going to be. Now, some people have a choice to choose who their father and mother is going to be. They would like to be the daughter of the Queen of England, or the daughter of Barack Obama, as the case may be. You want to be the daughter or the son of the richest man in the world. But you didn't make that choice for yourself. And because you didn't make that choice, God in his infinite wisdom understood what you were meant to accomplish on planet Earth. And he looked at you and he said, wow, what kind of combination do I need to put together in order to package this person and make him ready for what he's going to do on planet Earth? And then he looks around and said, wow, I need to look for a man from Osun State, another man from Kano, and another woman from Kano, and bring them together, because I know that the combination of those people will release certain genes, and those genes are actually going to form certain personality in whom I want to use to do certain things in the world. So God is a master strategist. He has everything all planned out. He said, before you were formed, I knew you. Before you came out of your mother's womb, I separated you, I sanctified you, and I ordained you to be a prophet to the nation. Before you were formed, I knew you. That's what God said. So that means that you didn't just come to earth because your mom and dad decided to have sex, and therefore you became an accidental child. There's nothing like an accidental child. There's actually nothing like an illegitimate child. You may have an illegitimate process, but you do not have an illegitimate child. The child is legitimate because God released the spirit into that child. Whether you like it or not. So it doesn't matter how you came. The most important is that you came. Do you believe that? And I know that in the church they have taught us many times that you came into the world naked and we came empty. We came empty and we're going to go back empty. That is half-truth. Yes, because you may have come naked, but you came loaded. Amen. You came loaded so that you can die empty. Do you understand? You came loaded with a lot of potential. You came loaded with a lot of giftings. You came loaded with a lot of ideas. You came loaded with a lot of things that God wants to do through you. And God's mandate for your life is so that by the time you are leaving this world, you will have offloaded every single thing you came with so that you can die empty. So it's okay to go back empty. But you did not come empty-handed. So you need to understand that. You didn't come empty-handed at all. You were loaded with potential. God has a plan for you. God has a plan for you. Tell your neighbor for me that God has a plan for you. And he has loaded with you with everything that you need to accomplish that plan. Amen. Amen. Let's look at the first family in the book of Genesis chapter 1. You know, the Bible says that God created heaven and earth in the beginning. And then one of the things that God did on the sixth day, praise God forevermore, was to create man on the sixth day. Praise God. You know, God created man on the sixth day, and then he rested on the seventh day. So that means when man woke up onto the seventh day. You get the picture? So that means man woke up into a rest. Now, God walked for 6 days, then he rested. But for man has to rest in the finished work of God before he can walk. Do you believe that? Now, let's go back again a little bit. God created man on the sixth day, according to the scripture. I know the scientists want to disprove that, as the case may be. But I was also one of those people who were so fascinated by science. As a matter of fact, I was the president of science club when I was growing up. And we were so very, very inquisitive about things around nature and stuff like that. And then I was a very good mathematician as well. So there was a time we're trying to like come with all those mathematics theory to try to prove that there was nothing like eternity. And then we got stuck somewhere. As a little child, you can imagine. Now, but let's go back a little bit. Now, God created man on the sixth day and he rested on the seventh day. So God's idea is that when man wakes up, the first thing he needs to do is to rest. I know so many of you are struggling right now, and God is asking me to tell you that you only need to first rest in the finished work of Christ. You need to rest in that. You need to accept the fact that this is what God has done for you when Jesus died on the cross of Calvary. And because of the acceptance of that truth, then you can have access into the things that he has in store for you. God created man. And when God created man, Genesis chapter 1 verse 26. He created man in his own image. Let us make man in our own image. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle, over the earth, over every creeping thing that creep on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female, he created he them. Praise God. Praise God. I won't say much more than that. Male and female, he created them. So as the case, he created male and female. Praise God forevermore. God didn't make a mistake. And God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply and subdue the heart and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the head, over every living thing that created and creepeth on the surface of the heart. So God created them and blessed them and said, be fruitful. That's what he said. He didn't give them a commandment. He gave them a blessing. There's two different things. Now, if he had commanded them to say, be fruitful, that means that they have to carry out a command, right? But God said, I blessed them. That means I infused them with the ability to be fruitful. So whether they like it or not, they have the ability on the inside of them to be fruitful. So God blessed them and said, be fruitful. Be fruitful. I have given you all the things that you need to be fruitful. So you do not have any other choice. You are wired to be fruitful. You are wired to be fruitful. You are built to be fruitful. You are loaded to be fruitful. You are empowered to be fruitful. Amen. That is who you are. You are empowered to be. I say, so when God created man, he gave man and he made him in charge. Man was in charge. Man was in charge. Man had the ability. Adam, for example, had the ability to name things. God actually brought all the animals before him. And then he asked Adam to name each one of those animals. And whatsoever Adam called those animals, that is what they are. So man was in charge. But man fell at some point in time. And since man fell, one of the things that God did was to create a solution for the story of man, to redeem man from a fallen state, to bring man to what God wants him to be. So if you're a man in this place, God has restored you back to your position when you accepted Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior. So if you're a man in this place, God, one of God's mandate for your life is that God has created you to be the leader in the house. The leader gives direction and shapes the destiny of his home. God has created you to be the spiritual leader. God has created you to ensure that you are the one that actually carries the vision of your family. God has created you and saddled you with authority over your household. And that authority means that whatsoever you allow on earth is allowed in heaven. So you need to understand that as a man, God has given you an authority over your household. So if there's something in your household that you are not so proud of right now, God is asking me to tell you that you've got the authority to change it. Because whatsoever you allow on earth is allowed in heaven. Whatsoever that you do not like in your child right now, whatsoever you do not like in your daughter right now, in your son, as the case may be, God has asked me to tell you, you've got an authority to change that by speaking into the life of those child. The man is also the provider. God has created man to be the provider in the house, as the case may be. The Bible says, he that does not provide for his own household is worse than an infidel. And I want to take us to the story of 2 Kings, 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 4. Even though I'm talking about the family and the role of the man, but I'm also speaking about this in the context of going from good to great, as the case may be. Now, 2 Kings chapter 4 is a story that is so interesting, and it's a story I pray that none of our men will be like this person. 2 Kings chapter 4. And let's start to read from verse 1. That's our text. A certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophet cried out to Elisha, saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant fears the Lord. And the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slaves. Wait a minute. Your servant, my husband, that's the woman talking, is dead. And you know that the servant fears the Lord. The contradiction is that the creditor is coming to take his two sons as slaves. That means he fears the Lord, but he was in debt. He was a debtor. He fears the Lord, but he died as a debtor. And therefore, the creditor is taking his two sons as slaves. And I'm wondering, what kind of a legacy is a servant of God leaving for his family, and he fears the Lord? And I'm wondering, if he fears the Lord, he is supposed to be able to walk in the principles of God. You cannot afford to leave your family in a crisis as a man. But that's not my point this morning. I just wanted to say that. But you see, the creditor is coming to take my two sons as slaves. And then Elisha asked the woman, and he said, what do you want me to do for you? And I was like, Elisha, didn't you understand the situation? This woman said, my sons are about to become slaves because my husband was owing. And you are asking me, what do you want me to do for you? Does that really sound like somebody who was listening? But that statement and that question from Elisha is very valid. Because if you did not believe that that question was valid, then you probably would be asking, why was Jesus asking the blind Bartimaeus, what do you want me to do for you? Because Jesus did the same thing. Blind Bartimaeus was crying after Jesus. He said, Jesus, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me, right? And Jesus like, okay, blind Bartimaeus, what do you want me to do for you? And I'm like, Jesus, this guy is blind. So if he's crying for you to have mercy on him, then it must mean that he actually wanted to see. But no, Jesus didn't want to make an assumption. Because blind Bartimaeus may be interested in getting money from Jesus. Blind Bartimaeus may be interested in asking Jesus to help him with somebody to cross the road. Now, blind Bartimaeus might be interested in all kinds of things, but Jesus was asking him a specific question, what do you want me to do for you? Now, if you were going to move from where you are to where you want to be, the first question that God asked me to ask you this morning is, what do you want? Can you really define what you want? Can you really define it? Are you so specific about what you want? Because until you are able to define what you want, really, you have not begun the process of looking for it. Now, because I've seen so many people chasing shadows in life. I've seen so many people chasing all kinds of things, running around in circles. And you ask them, what exactly do you want out of this life? What do you want to achieve? Why are you so busy and running around and you don't have time for God? Why are you so busy running around the streets of Lagos or the streets of London, as the case may be, and you don't have a direction? And then every time there's something that is moving, they're selling now computers, what is selling right now. Then you go and open a computer shop. Now it is mobile apps that everybody is getting into right now. Now you want to learn how to make mobile apps. Now it is hairdressing that people are interested in right now. Now you want to get into hairdressing. Now, right now, people are interested in having churches because people think that the way to get wealth actually is to actually start a church so that people can give their tithes and offering, and therefore you can then control all the tithes and offering in the church. So a lot of people are springing up with churches as a survival strategy. Now, it is because they have not been able to figure out what they want, what they want out of life. Now, the only way you can know what you really want out of life is to look back to your creator and say, what have you created me to be? Elisha asked this woman, he said, what do you want me to do for you? And then the second question Elisha asked this woman is, what do you have in your house? Two things. What do you want? What do you have? What do you want? What do you have? What do you want? What do you have? Now, Elisha was very serious asking the woman what she has, because so many times we always think that we do not have anything. And that is what the woman said. The woman said, your maidservant has nothing. How can you say that you have nothing? But you now said, except a jar of oil. So that means in the midst of your having nothing, there is a jar of oil somewhere in the house that you're not looking at. If you are going to move from where you are to where you want to be, if God is going to take you from the level of being just being good enough to the level of greatness, the question he's going to be asking you is, what do you have? I have never seen anyone that God used, whether in the Old Testament or in the New Testament, that he didn't ask that question. When he was going to ask Moses as well, and Moses was like, listen, I am a babbler. I cannot do anything. And God asked him, what do you have in your hand? He said, I have a rod. He said, that's enough for me. The rod that you have, with that rod, I am going to break the rock so that waters can come out. With that rock, I am going to part the Red Sea. With that rock, I'm going to make sure that the magicians of Egypt were actually put to shame, because with that rod, I am going to turn blood, I mean water into blood. With that rod, I am going to do so many things. And Moses will have underestimated the rod. And God is saying, that rod is enough for me. When Jesus was going to feed 5,000 people, and he asked the disciples and said, oh, feed them. And the disciples are saying to Jesus, Jesus, we don't have anything. Jesus said, what do you mean you don't have anything? He said, we don't have anything except 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And Jesus said, that is just enough for me. Whatever you have is enough for me. That's what God is saying right now. Now, a lot of people think that the miracle of feeding the 5,000 is the greatest miracle. But I think that the greatest miracle there is not the feeding of the 5,000, is the preservation of the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes. Because look, don't forget that the boy that packed the 5 loaves and 2 fishes was just a boy. That was supposed to be his lunch, right? The fact that the boy did not eat that before it was time, that was a miracle. Because he was an hungry boy. It was a preservation of what? See, if that boy had eaten the 5 loaves and 2 fishes, then Jesus wouldn't have anything to walk with. So the greatest miracle is actually the preservation of that thing that you are carrying in your hand that you did not know that the value of it. I'm sure the boy did not know the value of the 5 loaves and 2 fishes. He didn't know the value of it. Just like so many of you sitting on here right now, you do not know the value of what you have. You do not know the value of the connections you have. You do not know the value of the potentials that you have. You do not know the value of God placing you in an environment. You have underestimated the value of what you have, and that is why you've not been able to do anything with it. God will always preserve something for you, and he will ask you to look inward. What do you have? And then this woman said, I have just a jar of oil. And then Elisha asked the woman, he said, go and borrow vessels from everywhere, from your neighbor. Empty vessels. Do not gather a few. And when you have come in, shut the door behind you and your sons and then pour it into all those vessels and set aside the full ones. When God asks you what you have in your hands, the next thing he wants you to do is to say, go and find people who need what you have and pour yourself into them. Go and find people. Go and look for people who need what you have and begin to pour yourself into them. Because the people need what you have, begin to pour yourself into them and begin to pour yourself. Make sure that the people you're looking for, those vessels are empty, and make sure that there are many, not a few. Because if you're going to make an impact, that impact will be massive. So you need to look for people who need what you have and you begin to pour yourself into them. And look at what the woman did. The woman went from Elisha and shut the door behind her. That talks about focus for me. In being able to take advantage of what you have, you need to have focus. You need to be able to shut the door against the distractors. You need to be able to shut the door against the people who are going to distract you, the people who are going to pull you down, the people who are going to tell you it's not possible, the people who are going to tell you, listen, that's what you usually say. The people who are going to tell you that this thing cannot happen, you need to shut the door against those people and begin to focus. Surround yourself with people that believe in your cause. Surround yourself with people that believe in the agenda that you have. The woman surrounded herself with her sons and said, listen, we are in this together. If we don't solve this problem together, you are going to end up to become like a slave out there. Because we need to solve this problem together. We need to ensure that we are together in this thing. We need to ensure that we shut the door against the distractors. We need to ensure that we shut the door against the people who are going to laugh at us, who are going to scorn at us, who are going to say, what do you want to do with a jar of oil? Are you crazy? You are going to get sold and you are shutting yourself behind a closed door with empty vessels. Focus on what you have and begin to pour yourself into the people that need what you have. And then the truth of the matter was that when the woman finished pouring the oil into the vessel, she went ahead to sell it, right? Now, when you begin to render service to people, you begin to pour yourself into the people that need what you have, all your debts will be paid. All your debts will be paid. All your debts will be paid. The reason why you have a money problem is because you have a service problem. Your money problem is a service problem. Because there are people who need the services that you can render. Don't tell me you cannot do anything. Don't tell me that the economy is hard. Don't tell me that, oh, the UK economy is very hard right now, and therefore I was trained to be a computer scientist, and therefore there are no jobs in the IT industry anymore. Reinvent yourself, because there is something else that you have that the society and the community needs right now that will bring you into relevance. Only if you will look deeply within yourself, you will find what you have. As I begin to round up, I want us to go into the parable, the famous parable, the parable of the talent. Even though it is called the parable of the talent, but I actually want to call it the tales or the parable of three men. Because there are three men that were actually talked about in that. That's Matthew chapter 25. Matthew 25. Matthew 25. From verse 14, it's a parable that Jesus Christ was talking about a certain man. The kingdom of heaven is like unto a man. I love Jesus's parable because within those parables, there are a lot of eternal truth embedded in them. He said, for the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And to one he gave 5 talents, and to the other one he gave 2, and to the other one he gave 1, to each according to his own ability. And immediately he went on a journey. Then he who had received 5 talents went and traded with them. Everybody say traded with them. And made 5 other talents. And likewise, he who has received 2 talents gained 2 more. But he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came to settle the account with them. Everybody say settle the account with them. There's going to be a day of reckoning. Salvation is by grace. Hallelujah. But rewards is by works. Praise God forevermore. We focus on salvation, right? We want to get to heaven. But please don't just only focus on getting to heaven, because getting to heaven is by grace, right? By what Jesus Christ has done, right? It's not by your own goodness. It is by what Jesus Christ has done on the cross of Calvary. Therefore, getting to heaven is not by your own works. When the Bible says you should work out your salvation, it didn't say work for your salvation. It said work it out, right? So let the inworking of God on the inside of you be made manifested on the outside. It didn't say work for it, because you can never work for your salvation. Hallelujah. Praise God forevermore. So salvation is by grace, but rewards is by works. Don't just get satisfied with making to heaven. That's the least. What about the crowns? What about the rewards? What about the placement in heaven? You need to be concerned about your placement in heaven and not just making heaven. There's some people who will make heaven and just by passing through fire. They just escaped the hellfire and they're happy. I mean, by the time they realize that, listen, there is much more than to just escaping hellfire. There is much more. God wants to make people who will rule over kingdoms in the new heaven and the new heart, and your work on heart today will guarantee you your positioning in the new heaven and the new heart. There is a day of reckoning. He came to settle an account with them. And the person who received 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents. Said, Lord, you delivered unto me 5. Look, I have gained 5 more talents beside them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. And he who had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, you have delivered unto me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more besides them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Then the one who had received 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man. You were reaping, you reap where you have not sown, and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid, and I went to hide the talent in the ground. Look, have what is yours. Now, let's look at these 3 men. There's someone who received 5 talents, and the other one that received 2, and the other one that received 1. Now, the one that received 5 or 2 or 1, they got those according to the master's estimation of their abilities. Right? So now, the guy who received 5 could have felt superior to the other people. To say, listen, hey, look, I am the big dog around here, man. I got 5 and you only got 2. He could have felt superior to other people. Since he was given talent, he would have felt, listen, if you gave me 5, it's because my ability is much more bigger than your ability. And therefore, he could have started to glory in his own abilities and look down on the other people who received 2. And he's wondering, he's feeling like one king, one blind eye king, sorry, in the category or in the city of the blind. He knew that he had those abilities. And he could have fallen victim of human comparison. Some of you who have been given much in life, and you look down on other people who have not been given much, and you begin to wonder, listen, you're not good enough. See, if you are really a man of faith, you understand, you will have houses on Park Lane, just like me, you know. It's because your faith is not strong enough. Who told you that the measure of how strong your faith is the location of where you have your house? Who told you that? If that is the case, then Richard Branson should have been the greatest man of faith in the UK right now, isn't it? Hello? Superiority complex could have prevented the guy. The guy understood that to whom much is given, much is required, and he went ahead to trade with what he has. He did not even start to compare himself with the guy who got 2. He did not allow himself to start feeling a little bit excited that the master estimated him much more than he estimated the other people. He went straight to work, and he started trading. And the man who got two, you can imagine that you got two. You could have actually begin to compare yourself and feel bad. God, why did you give me two? I thought that me and Tony went to the same school. We graduated with the same degree. How come he has two houses and I've got five houses and I've got two? How come he has £500,000 in his account and I've got 200,000? We didn't come into this world with two heads. We came, you understand what I mean? And some of our parents also haven't made it easy for some of the young men, especially those who have migrated to London, right? Because there are certain guy who migrated to London many years ago and he started sending cars home. He started building houses. And then they will compare you with the person who is building houses and say, listen, is it not the same London we sent you to? And you have not even bought a bicycle. And then this is the guy, he's building houses and they compare you with them. Listen, you are not running the same race. It is a tragedy to run a race that you have to win a race you have not been called to run. So if you have not been called to run a specific race, don't worry about what you have been given. You need to just ensure that you focus on it. God gave it to you because he knew what your abilities are. Some people are trusting God. God, I received the anointing of a billionaire. Who told you that you can manage the anointing of a billionaire? If you receive $1 billion in your account right now, some people will go crazy. Yes. They won't even come to church anymore. So, see, the reason why God prevented you from getting $1 billion is because he loved you. He loved you enough to make sure that you did not get that money. Some ladies who are trusting God to get married, and then you don't even know how to clean, how to cook, how to take care of children. You do not know how to take care of a man. You don't even know how to take care of yourself. And you're saying, my biological clock is ticking, God. You see, you need to. And God is saying that I created time where I don't live in it. Praise God forevermore. See, he loved you enough to keep you single because he knows that if you ever give your husband in the current state that you have found yourself, you'll be thrown out of the window the next week. He loved you enough. He makes all things beautiful in his time. He is preparing you for the place he has prepared for you. And until you are ready for it, he's not going to give it to you because he loved you enough to keep it away from you. The guy who got two, he did not underestimate himself. He did not succumb to a faulty comparison. He did not pursue ambition. He did not try to overdo or underdo, as the case may be. He took what he has been given and walked with it. And he vowed that it will reproduce according to his kind. Both of them went to work. And the next thing I saw in this, before I started talking about the man who got one, do you know that the Bible says that when the master gave them the talent, the Bible says immediately he proceeded on his journey. That tells me that he had so much confidence in those people's abilities. He knew they could deliver according to his expectation. He didn't even waste time. He was not concerned whether they're going to do it or not. He proceeded on his journey. God has so much confidence in you. God has so much confidence in you. Regardless of what you have been given, God has so much confidence in you. He trusts you enough to go to sleep to say, hey, because I know that this son of mine is going to deliver. I know. I don't have to worry. God is looking at you and you are like concerned. Oh God, I don't know how I'm going to do it. Today you woke up and you don't have money in your bank account. Today you woke up, you don't even know how you're going to get to church. You woke up and you didn't even know how you're going to feed and you're wondering. And God is still saying that I have confidence in this man because I know this man is going to bless generations, because I know this man is going to feed nations, because I know this man is going to rebuild. See, that is what God is seeing. And you are looking at your immediate situation and you're wondering, God, what is all these things that you're talking to me? This vision that you're talking to, it doesn't look real. It looks as if it is something that will never come to pass. But God asked me to tell you that I have confidence in you. Whenever you repose confidence in someone, it enhances his competence. And whenever competence is enhanced and demonstrated, confidence is reinforced. That is just a tip for those of you who want to build a team. If you want to build a team, You need to ensure that you repose confidence in your team, in your team members. Because when you don't repose confidence in them, their competencies will be undermined. Well, even if they are not good enough, all what they need from you is your confidence. Because when you repose confidence in them, their competencies are enhanced. That is that one edge that you just needed. A lot of people fail on their jobs, not because they do not have the skills, but because they lack the confidence to perform. And because they are afraid of their bosses. They are intimidated by their bosses. I used to be in a situation whereby I had a boss who was always trying to find fault in what I do. And I look at myself, listen, I'm an international executive. I cannot be intimidated by this guy. So I had to speak to myself every morning before I come out of the house. I will speak to myself, listen, I will not be intimidated. I will call his name. I said, I will not be intimidated by you because I am confident in what I have and I will come to work. I told myself that every time because I know that if only I allow him to intimidate me, everything that I have built over the years can fly out of the window. Praise God forevermore. God, and the next thing that I want to point out here, the Bible says in the book of Matthew 25, verse 19. I want you to read it. Matthew 25, 19. He said, after a long time, the Lord of those servants came to settle accounts with them. Everybody say, after a long time. You know, the immediate thinking of many of us when we read this parable is that this guy's got 5 talents and they just doubled it to 5. Right? That's immediate thinking. So you want a double anointing as a case baby, right? Double portion. Because the guy who got 5 doubled it to 5, right? And the guy who got 2 doubled it to 2, right? The Bible says, after a long time. So if the master took a long time to come, and then he tells me that those people took a long time to trade with what they have been given in order to produce to the potential that God has given them. It did not happen overnight. It took a long time to happen. Guys, you see, the person who got 5 could have actually gotten 1, right? He traded with 5 to get 6, right? He would trade with 6 to get 7. And in the process of trading with 7, he could actually lose 2 so that he gets back to 5. But after a long time, the account balances up and then he produced 5 after a long time. See, precept has to follow precept. Lies have to follow lies. You are not going to make it overnight. I am tired of the overnight miracle preachers. See, one of my mentors told me, when somebody told him many years ago, he said, listen, you have just become an overnight success. He said, if this is what you call an overnight success, he said, but then it means that I must have been sleeping for a very long time. He said that must have been the longest night in my entire history. As a roundup, guys, my time is fast spent. Now, do you know that the reward, the commendation received by the person who got 5 is the same commendation received by the person who got 2? Well done, thou good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in few. I will make you rulers over many. Same reward. Same commendation. It is according to the abilities he has given you that is going to measure your result. If the guy who got 5 delivered 3, he would not get the same commendation as the guy who got 2 and delivered 2. You understand? Stop comparing yourself with somebody else, guys. You will become what God has called you to become. And what God has called you to become is good enough. And then when you begin to walk with the understanding of what you have received from him, and you begin to reproduce after what he has given you, you will just not become an ordinary person. You will be someone who has lived up to his potential. This, what we're talking about here, is when God looks at you and say, well done. The mark of greatness is not in the celebration from man. It's not in the acknowledgement of human being. It's not in the acknowledgement of your friends. It is the acknowledgement of God the Father himself looking at you and say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. The Bible says we are surrounded with so great crowd of witnesses. We have witnesses of saints that have gone, that died and gone away, but they are still cheering us up in heaven. At the same time, we have witnesses of people, the next generation, who are yet to be born. And they are waiting for us to fulfill our potential. Are you going to live up to your potential? The Bible says a little one of you will become a thousand. Listen, if you do not know how much impact God wants you to have in life, understand that the minimum people God wants you to impact before you die is 1,000 people. 1,000. Can 1,000 people line up before you or behind you on the throne of heaven and say, because of the life of this person, I have become who I am? One will chase 1,000. See, you will always see it replicated. Two will put 10,000 to flight. The minimum people is 1,000. Let it become the beginning of the vision that you have. Don't hide your potential. Let the master celebrate you. It's not every one of you that will ever become millionaires. And it's not your cause. Because some of you don't need to become a millionaire in pounds before you fulfill the vision of God for your life. Some of you can make do with 500,000 and still get the same commendation like the guy who got 10 million pounds. Do you understand? Stop measuring yourself by the fact that how much you have in your bank account. That is so mundane. That is so unchristlike. That is so ungodly. Because that God is not measured by gold and silver. Hallelujah. 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 Are you excited this morning? Get up on your feet and just thank God for what you have. Thank God for what you have. Thank God for what you have been given. Thank God for what you have been given. Thank God for what you have been given. You have been given something. And he has confidence in you. 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 He knows you can deliver. He knows you can perform. He knows you can live up to expectation. God has confidence in you. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We give you praise. We celebrate you this morning. Because we know that you have us in mind. Before you formed us, you knew us. And we know that you have separated us to become a prophet to the nations. You have sent us to the nations. And therefore we receive that calling. And I speak to the life of these people here and I say, a little one of them will become 1,000. A small one will become a strong nation. That is the mandate of God over your life. Be fruitful and multiply and replenish. Leave your footprint on the sands of time. Be a blessing to your generation. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Celebrate the Lord God this month.
Also, make sure you add us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. And visit the church website.